Is a good morning, and it's good that we are gathered here together this day for this time of worship. As we begin, I'd like to invite you to take a moment to look at some of the announcements that are in your bulletin. I'm going to start with the insert here. This is Human Relations Day. It's one of our special offerings we take across the year. Take a moment to read through the information of what this special offering will go for. Give it some prayerful consideration, and then when it comes time for the offering, you can respond as you are led to do so. As we have this opportunity to support ministries for community outreach and youth who are at risk. If you haven't already done so, I invite you to take a moment to sign the friendship pads along the edge of the pew there, and be sure to pass them all the way down and around the bend so everybody has a chance to sign. And then if you pass them back, you have a chance to see who it is that you're sharing the pew with. We invite any and all of our first-time guests to be sure to grab one of the welcome bags from either the table at the back or the Welcome Center out by the main entrance there. I want to continue to thank you for your support with the name tags. With that, for those of you who have them, with that, it's really a big help. For those of you who are wearing your name tags in spirit, we appreciate the intent. For those who have put the name tags in very safe places, we can help you out. If you sign the clipboard around the corner, we can get you another one ordered with that. A reminder that 1 week from today, next Sunday, is Youth Sunday. And I know for a fact that there are some very special plans that are being made, some of which are involving, some which are still in process, in order to provide for us a very special experience 1 week from today. So mark it in your calendars, make a special effort to get the word out. Anybody who is chose to stay where it is warm and safe today and not be here to hear this, you can help out by giving the word to them across this next week that this next Sunday is our Youth Sunday with that. We do also want to express our appreciation for our altar flowers that are shared with us today in honor of Sarah Schroeder and Amy Oliver for their birthdays. We want to give our thanks to the families for their sharing and their generosity. Do we have any other announcements, additions, or corrections that we need to be aware of this morning?
This Wednesday, our TAG youth are going to have a real live game of Clue, and we are in need of some adults who might want to help with that. It's from 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m., and no adults are harmed in the making of this Clue game, just so you know. But if you're interested in being a Mrs. Peacock or Mr. Green, just let me know. You have a script that gives you all of the information that you know, and the kids will come around to ask you all sorts of questions. So see me if you can help with that. Thanks.
Thank you. Are there any others? Then I invite you to stand as you're able that you can greet each other with your signs of love and reconciliation.
Reading, we will hear the Apostle Paul's words to the Corinthians about the work of the Holy Spirit. But who is the Holy Spirit? I'll leave such questions to the theologians, but you don't need to be a scholar to appreciate the work of God's Spirit in your life. The Spirit prompts a young person to ask questions such as, why am I here? And what is my purpose in this world? The Spirit rejoices when you offer a genuine thank you, or better yet, a heartfelt I'm sorry. The Spirit convicts you that the small slight you received from that annoying relative should not be the excuse to sever your relationship. The Spirit shows you that serving can often be more of a blessing than leading. The Spirit prompts you that you've spent enough time on your computer and it would be more valuable to interact with your loved ones. The Spirit surprises you by helping you understand that that foreigner who speaks broken English, eats peculiar food, and has a strange belief system essentially has the same desires and hurts as you. And as we advance in years, the Spirit opens our eyes to see that while our bodies weather the years of usage like an 83 Honda Accord, our souls endure and can shine brightly in a cynical world. We will best serve ourselves and others when we are open to the Spirit's leadings. Let us pray. Spirit of truth, thank you for your enduring patience. Your promptings in our lives are so necessary to rise above our noisy minds in a hollow, boasting world. Teach us to be open to your still, small voice. Amen.
Entering moment. Now, would you please stand if you are able for our call to worship? There are many gifts, talents, and abilities given by God. There are a variety of things we can do to serve the Lord.
But it is the same Lord we all serve.
There are many activities we can do to serve God. Teach, sing, clean, preach, play, work.
But all these are activated by God.
There are many manifestations of God's Spirit in the world. To say that one is better than the other is foolish. And now please remain standing if you are able for the opening hymn, Many Gifts, One Spirit, number 114 in the United Methodist Hymnal.
Thank you.
may be seated. You all need to sing a lot louder to beat the piano right behind me. It's very pretty. Would you please join me in the opening prayer? Holy God, we gratefully acknowledge the gifts you have lavished upon us. We praise you for daily walking with us. We thank you for your peace and comfort that encourage us in the midst of difficulty. We bless you for your grace, which is sufficient for every need, just as we need it. You have strengthened us, as the Apostle Paul said, to wait for the redeeming of all creation, and as we wait, to live as your kingdom people. We ask that you meet us in our gathered worship. Speak, convict, comfort, and renew us so that we leave here empowered to proclaim the truth of your love through our every word and word. Through the gifts and blessings you give us, help us to touch the lives we meet in ways that show the unfolding of your kingdom. Amen. For our scripture reading this morning, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 through 11 on page 163 in the New Testament section of your pew Bible, we hear something of a spiritual gifts 101 sort, that there are many gifts but one spirit. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Holy Spirit of God ever says, "Let Jesus be cursed." And no one can say, "Jesus is Lord," except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit. To another gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another the working of miracles. To another prophecy. To another the discernment of spirits. To another various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of the tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. This is the word of God. And now the Carillon Choir will play for the beauty of the earth.
Please come up for children's time. We have something to show you this morning. This is a big group. That's great. This is a treat. Anyone know the name of this pretty flower that Billy's holding? Remember that? It's an amaryllis. Do you remember, some of you may, in October, Billy brought this bulb, this thing that looks like it's dead. She brought that, and you planted it in dirt, and in that bulb was food and a shoot that made this whole thing grow. Do you think she did anything to make that grow, or did she just put it in a closet and leave it? What do you think she did? Yes. She did. She watered it. Yes. Right. You're exactly right. She kept it by a window with sunshine. We're going to talk about the different parts of this amaryllis. Now, the ones of you that are close, can you see that bulb? Some of it sticking up above the ground? Yeah, some of it is. And underneath that are a bunch of roots that went down in, and they suck up just like straws. They suck up water. So the roots are important. They bring up the water, and the bulb is important too. Now we're going to talk about the other parts of this. What is this? Yes. It's a leaf. And the leaf takes the sunshine and the air, carbon dioxide from the air, and makes food for the plant. So that's what that does. What part is this? Stem. What does anyone know what the stem does? Yes. Right. You're exactly right. Transfers that water, just like a straw that you suck on. It transfers that water through the plant. And it also holds up the flower, doesn't it? Makes it easier for us to see the flower. And of course, you know the flower. That's the thing we like best, isn't it? Very pretty. Okay, now, the church is like the amaryllis plant. You know, each one of these, each part of the plant had something important to do, didn't it? Stem, the leaf, each one did something different. And the church, the people here in the church have many different ways that they help. Who knows a way, somebody that does something to help in our church? Does anybody know? Yes. Yeah, Jennifer does the Wednesday dinners. Who else knows? Yes. People that serve snacks after church. Yes, that's nice. We can all eat and have coffee and talk together and get to know each other better. That's important. Yes. People who serve on Wednesday. And you know, there's some people here that help on Wednesday too. You and your sister and brother help clean up every Wednesday night, don't you? They take, you know what they do after the meal? They take their plates up to the dishwasher and they go and help clear the tables. Yes, we really appreciate what you do too. Okay, yes. You to help your mom and dad. And you know, the church work doesn't just stop with the church. You do that at home. When you help, and when you in school, when you make somebody feel welcome, and maybe they're new, and that's right. And you know, you're learning a lot of things at home too, from your parents, from your school. Keep your ears open, learn all those good things, because God wants you to learn all those good things so you can grow up right. Right, lots of ways of helping your mom and dad, and that's where it starts. That's where you learn in the beginning. And, you know, so each thing you do, each person in the church does something different. Do we have any music in our church?
Yeah.
Yeah, who does the music? The bell people. How many of you sing in choir, in church choir? Anybody sing in church choir? Or sang at the Christmas program? Yeah, I think so, yes. And we like that, and it's good, you know, and it's very special if you can do something to help other people and help in church, because that's what God wants you to do. Okay, let's have a prayer. Please repeat after me. Thank you, God, for giving us things we can do to help our church and to help others. Please help us to do good things. Amen.
For several weeks, we've been following a series on transitions, and this week, it's the transitions having to do with moving from hospitality, or from French fellowship to hospitality. But in order to start our conversation about hospitality this morning, I'm going to invite you to go with me to an unusual place for that. I'm going to invite you into a chicken coop. The story from inside that chicken coop comes to us from another pastor, Barbara Brown Taylor. In her spare time, downtime, along with her husband on a small Georgia farm, they raised chickens. And she was telling of a time when she was in the part of their operation where she was working with the chicks that are in the incubator, and they were starting to hatch. And she was noting how all but one of the chicks had hatched out, but there was one that was really, really struggling with the process. It had managed to get about halfway out of its shell, and in the process had become so exhausted that it just couldn't finish the job. And there it lay. She lifted up how hard it was just to sit there and watch. She had this impulse where she wanted just to kind of swoop in there and become the super mother hen and get rid of that extra shell and set the chick free. But she knew in her head that wasn't the wise thing to do, because nature had a way of helping to decide who was the viable chicks and who were not. And she knew in her head that if the chick was not strong enough to get out of the shell, it would not be strong enough to survive once it was out and hatched. So she watched. And she watched as this little chick struggled and struggled and just couldn't get free. And finally it had exhausted itself to the point that it just kind of began just to lay there and put its head down on the floor of the incubator and was half in, half out of the shell and just was very still. And not knowing what else to do, she finally reached in and took a hold of the chick, eggshell and all, and moved it over to where the other hatch chicks were busy climbing on top of each other, trying to get close to the heat lamp to find some sort of of warmth in this new and very big world. And she just lay this chick half out of the shell just in the box with the rest. The other chicks were busy chirping and making all kinds of noise as they were going through this rather dramatic chaos, trying to get close to the source of warmth in that. And the one little chick, half out of the shell, heard all the chirping and cheeping and gave one little chirp itself. And with that one little chirp, all the other chicks stopped and turned their heads towards the one half out of the shell, and they began to chirp to it. And in a few moments, all that chirping coming at it gave the one chick a little bit of revitalization, and it gave one more big shake and shudder, and it came out of the shell. And once free, it ran over and buried itself into that whole pile of squirming bodies in order to find some warmth. The power there of a community. Pastor Taylor Brown discovered that really her job at this point really was not to help the chicks get out of the shell. Her job was to make sure they had a safe place, to make sure that any predators or other threats or dangers were held at bay while the community there did what it was designed to do. The story happened in a chicken house, but it was a story for us about hospitality. You see, hospitality is that whole process of connecting people to community who were not otherwise already connected. It's about showing that other person is a valued child of God. Hospitality is far more than just being friendly to somebody. It's far more than even being a good host or hostess. It is welcoming that other into your life as if they truly belonged there. Now, the lesson that we heard this morning was a portion of a letter that the Apostle Paul had written to the church at Corinth. And in the portion that we read this morning, he's talking to them about the spiritual gifts. When we hear that list, we begin to kind of assess whether we've got that gift or any gift, and we begin to wonder where we would fit in. But that's exactly what the Corinthians were doing, only they also took it one step farther. When they decided that I've got this gift or you got that gift, they would then begin to arrange those gifts as far as what they thought was more important, what they thought was less important, and then whoever possessed that gift then was also either more important or less important to the life of the church. Paul was writing to them to make clear that each one of those gifts were not given in order to sort people out one way or the other. Instead of using those gifts to decide who was in and who was out, he was reminding them that God has given each and every one of those gifts for the good of the whole, for the good of the community. And the gift was there to connect folk, not to sort them out. He's writing to them to set the record straight as far as what that was all about. It was not so much a letter defining spiritual gifts as it was a letter defining what it means to be in community and what it is that connects us one to another to create community. And that is God's Holy Spirit. In our congregational reorganization, the decision was made that we needed a committee devoted to the ministry of hospitality. This was done in order that we might recognize the importance of connecting people to each other to create that community based in faith. That decision was made to make sure that more than just making folk feel welcomed when they walk through the doors on Sunday morning, that they know that they are a valued child of God. It was more than just making sure that we have in place ways to be gracious hosts and hostess at our fellowship time. It was more than making sure we had someone to shake a hand of somebody else or with those who were seated around us. It was put in place to make sure that we not only do all of those things, but we do whatever it takes that people understand they are valued in the eyes of God. Each and every one holds a sacred worth. Hospitality are the ministries of recognizing that this person before you is a beloved child of God, that this person next to you is the very one from whom Christ died and rose again. Our hospitality is our commitment that each and every person will know that, and that they will also experience that. You see, God has equipped each of us to be in community. We are even designed to be connected in profound and transformative ways. And just like that little chick in Reverend Taylor Brown's story, we thrive when we are connected and we languish when we're not. Our gifts, just like those of the Corinthians, exist for the common good. They all come from the same God for the sake of God's people. You are who you are because the people around you need what God has blessed you with. Did you hear that? You are who you are because people need what God has blessed you with. And the ministries of opportunities, the ministry of hospitality, are all the opportunities where those gifts have a chance to reach out, connect, and transform lives. The kingdom is richer and it reaches much, much farther into the world because of you. You deny your gifts, you withhold your gifts, you selectively share your gifts, and the kingdom and the world are lesser for it. Hospitality is about the giving and the receiving of the gifts that the Spirit has blessed us with. Now, when you hear the words, "Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies, and thou anointest my head with oil," what comes to mind? The 23rd Psalm. You know, we hear those words so often that they are so familiar that sometimes we hear them and sometimes we just know they've been said. But what we don't always realize is those words come out of a different culture. They come out of a culture that was based upon hospitality. You see, in that desert experience, when somebody approached you, you had no choice but to receive them, because to deny them, to reject them, was almost a death sentence. When somebody would come to you, for whatever reason, you were obligated to receive them and offer your hospitality to them. So if I were to show up at your door, if I were to show up at your campsite with folk chasing me for whatever reason, you had no choice but to receive me. And you were required to receive and care for me for a minimum of 2 days and two nights. And for that 2 days and two nights, those who were pursuing, even if they caught up to me at that point, could come no closer than the circle of light that your campfire cast. They had to stop at that edge, and they had to wait there for at least 2 days and two nights. During that time, that enemy may have their anger and their rage begin to dissipate to the point of becoming frustration. And that frustration may dissipate even farther in that time of waiting to just being tired. And that tiredness may dissipate even farther in that time of waiting until they too sought the hospitality from within the circle. And enemies might even become friends. They might even become folk who share hospitality with one another. Transformation through acts of hospitality. Now, we don't live in a world that's devoid of water. That's not our threat. But we do live in an environment that can be life-threatening. The temperature extremes, if you can imagine today stepping outside without your coat, only to find that the car was locked and you don't have the keys with you, and you turn back into the church here in order to get your keys and your coat to find out the church doors have already been locked, and you are stuck outside. It's not a desert, but you got a problem. You got a problem when somebody helps out. Hospitality. We also live in a world, in an environment, where it's not always just the temperatures. Sometimes it's the economic realities that can leave a family without adequate shelter. Sometimes it's the economic realities that leave a family without adequate resources for food and for necessary medicine. Sometimes it's the physical and the social distance that leave folk isolated and alone. We do live in a world that more easily shares despair and fear than it does hope and love. But God has an answer to that. And that answer is you. You have been blessed and gifted by God's own Spirit in a way that you, together with the people around you, have the capacity to bring life into each and every one of those threatening situations. You have the gifts for hospitality. Sometimes we get so busy with the doing of things that all we find ourselves focusing on is the task. Is it done? What's the next one? Is it done? And we get so busy doing just what is before us that we become humans who are doing, and we forget that we were created to be humans being. When we take the time to be, we are fully present, fully engaged with the folk around us. We are in relationship. We are in community. We, by nature, are offering hospitality. It would be tempting, though. It would be tempting for us to avoid the hard and risky work of hospitality by convincing ourselves that we really have nothing to offer, that somebody else couldn't do better. And surely they'll step forward and do it. To claim that, though, to claim that your gifts really don't matter, that your gifts really aren't all that important, says that the gifts that God has given you don't really matter. And when you devalue the gift, you also devalue the giver. The giver of your gifts is the God who created you to be who you are. And there is no one in this world who can be a better you than you. Hospitality requires that each of us embrace our gifts and make them readily available through our lives together. It requires us to recognize the gifts of the other people that we are in community with, and in turn receive their gifts as they offer them to us. It gives us the opportunity to welcome into our lives those that we might meet as strangers, but who become our sisters and brothers in and through Christ. Every time we encounter somebody, that moment leaves us with two questions. Did we see Christ in them? And just as importantly, did they see Christ in us? It is those ministries and times of hospitality when we can give a yes to both of those. I invite you to stand as you're able, that we can join together in hymn number 620, One Body, One Bread. may be seated. As we gather today in this time and this place as a part of that one body, we come bringing with us all the joys and the cares that make up our lives. As we gather here today, are there requests for prayer? Yes. Request for continued healing for Deb. Thanks, Jeff. Are there others? Yes. I missed the names. Thank you much. Are there others?
Dave, I don't know if you've had the chance to meet Tim because he's been overseas most of the time you've been here, but it is a joy to have Tim back with us.
It is a joy to have Tim back with us, and we had a chance to briefly get acquainted. Yeah. But welcome home again. Are there others?
We should mention Jerry Holsey.
Yes, yes. We offered a prayer of thanksgiving to a very shy Jerry Holsing last hour for his nomination. He's in the final eight for Coach of the Year nationally for girls basketball. And we lift it up as a joy and thanksgiving last time, much to his embarrassment. But you know, that's okay. Are there others? Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you for all the times and ways in which we experience your hospitality, the ways in which you connect ourselves to our lives and in the process draw us to one another. We give our thanks to you for those. We lift up and give our thanks for the time yesterday when leaders of the congregation and the committees had a chance to come together and to explore what it is that we need to be about as we offer ourselves in service to this congregation and to you. We give our thanks and the joy for Tim's return home safely and in his presence with us this day. We thank you. We give our thanks that you create us in such a way that we can offer ourselves for the sake of others around us, and we join in celebrating Jerry's nominations as he has given himself to the girls that he coaches. We join in celebrating the good news from last hour, where Mike and Clara are celebrating the birth of Elliot Cameron, and we give our thanks for this gift of new life. And Lord, we thank you for those who have heard that call and offer themselves and their gifts for the sake of the rest of the community. We thank you for those who are a part of our Stephen ministry. We thank you for the work of the Trinity United Methodist Church there in Des Moines, and for the congregations inside and outside the well of Women at the Well. And Lord, we are mindful also that as we gather that there are those who are in need of the support of the community. And we lift before you those who are dealing with health matters, that they might find with you the comfort, the healing, the wholeness that they require. We lift before you this morning Margaret Nyswander and Vero Beck and Sandy Evans. We pray for those dealing with mental health concerns, whether it be their own or that of a loved one, that they receive the wholeness and the assurances that they require. We lift up Mitzi Peterson, and we pray for healing for her as she begins to work through her prognosis with a stomach tumor. And Lord, we hold Bob Mann before you, and we pray also for his healing. And Lord, as we lift up those, we also lift up Deb Breeden, and we pray for her continual healing and mending as she also deals with her health journey. Lord, we hold before you also those who are in that time of sorrow and grief. We pray for the Lockers and for the Wickwires. We also hold up Tammy Hall with the news of the death of her mother and her father's injuries in a car crash. We pray that each of these families might find the comforts and assurances they need as you walk with them through this time. But we are also aware that there are those who have matters before them that are of a long duration. We pray that they might find with you the strength that they need, the assurance that are required, and in the hospitalities that their situation needs, that they might be able to lean upon you and upon your people. We lift up before you Dennis and Darlene Anderson, Peyton Denmark, and Barb Story. We also hold before you Hunter Sturck, and we ask, Lord, that anywhere in this world that there is violence and lives are torn and rearranged by it, that there your peace would manifest itself. And we hold before you all of those who find themselves wounded, but also those who find themselves displaced, that they might find places of sanctuary, that they might begin to experience a healing and restoration of life. We pray for all of these things, as well as those things which we hold upon our hearts, as we pray as your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As the ushers now wait upon us, we are also reminded that we have both the opportunity and the privilege to be able to offer ourselves and our gifts to God. Let us pray together. Thank you, extravagant God, for your blessings in our lives. We offer ourselves in grateful response, seeking to live with such compassion toward others that your blessings will flow through us to bless our community and our world. For the sake of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 548, In Christ There Is No East or West. Now, as we prepare to leave this place, this moment, this space, we prepare to go in the name of Christ out into that world with God's love wrapped so tightly around us, it becomes a part of who we are. With our Christ choosing to walk with us in such a way that we do not travel life's journey alone. With God's own Spirit filling us and sustaining us to give us the strength we need for the journey. We prepare to go from this place, following Christ's light from here out into the world, that that world might know it has a Savior, and that Savior is Jesus Christ.